What is Bitcoin? In this video, I will explain Bitcoin from a non-technical perspective. I will use easy language and examples that help you to understand everything better. Bitcoin was introduced during the financial crisis in 2008 by a group or person under the name of Satoshi Nakamoto. In a 9-page PDF document, they describe how Bitcoin works and what makes it special and important to all of us. I will not cover every detail of the so-called white paper, but I will try to explain Bitcoin's most important features. Bitcoin, a peer-to-peer electronic cash system. Let us start with that. Every one of you knows what cash is. Some of us still use it on a daily basis to purchase goods and services. We use coins and bills. Once we give our cash to someone, this cash is not in our possession anymore, and we cannot give the same bills or coins to someone else. So far, so good. If one person gives cash to another person, you could call it peer-to-peer. One peer gives cash to the other peer. Simple like that. There is no need for someone in between, a middleman, or a bank, or to verify the peer-to-peer cash transfer from one person to another. And Bitcoin in its core is exactly this, just electronic. You can send or transfer Bitcoin from one person to another, just like cash. And the best is you don't need a middleman, for example, a bank or a company like PayPal or Visa, in order to do so. That you can do this peer-to-peer electronically is maybe the biggest and most important feature of Bitcoin. It also makes Bitcoin resistant and resilient. You don't have to trust anyone to store your Bitcoin or run the Bitcoin network. This is one of the reasons it's often called trustless, as there is no central authority controlling Bitcoin. Bitcoin can't be shut down. The only way for Bitcoin to disappear is if everyone that is running Bitcoin needs to be convinced to stop doing this. As of today, we are talking about tens of thousands of computers and companies all over the world. Together, they create the decentralized peer-to-peer Bitcoin network. The only way to shut down Bitcoin is to shut down the internet. And this is very unlikely to happen, especially when we were entering a time where the internet can be accessed via satellites from every corner of the earth. Access is also a very important topic for Bitcoin. As explained before, the Bitcoin network is a decentralized peer-to-peer network without a central authority or middleman. Everything is public at any time, every transaction, every address, often called a wallet or identity, that is used to send or receive Bitcoin. Even more important is that everyone can participate in Bitcoin without asking for permission. Think about it like a public park. Everyone can enter. You don't need to ask anyone to do so. This is why Bitcoin is also called public and permissionless. Bitcoin is for everyone. The only thing you need is an internet connection and a smartphone or computer. The easiest way to get started with Bitcoin is getting a Bitcoin wallet. It's like your physical wallet in your pocket, just as an app on your smartphone or computer. Once installed, you will receive an address and a key, usually 12 to 24 English words. The key is like your password. Only you know it, and only with the key you can access your Bitcoin. If you lose your key, you lose your Bitcoin. If someone gets to know your key, this person can access your Bitcoin. Therefore, it is advised to store the key in a very safe place and never show it to anyone. Think about it like the key to your physical treasure, so protect it well. You can create as many addresses as you want. It is completely free, public and permissionless for everyone in the world, no matter if your government allows it or not. Bitcoin is literally for everyone. So no one is or can be excluded, like you can't be excluded from receiving cash from someone who stands in front of you and is giving it to you. If only you have the key to your wallet, you become your own bank. You have full control and ownership of your Bitcoin, and no one can ever access them without your consent, or better said, without your key. If you die and don't pass the key to someone, your Bitcoin will be lost forever. Bitcoin gives you strong control and ownership, but it comes hand in hand with being self-responsible. There is no way to recover your Bitcoin once your key is lost or your Bitcoin has been sent to a different address. This sounds scary, but it is a very important feature of Bitcoin. Also, the fact that Bitcoin transfers are non-reversible, you can't get them back or call someone once sent. Remember, there are no middlemen, Bitcoin is peer-to-peer. The fact that you can't take back Bitcoin you sent to someone also ensures that you can't send the same Bitcoin to multiple people. Again, think about cash. If you have a bill, pass a bill to someone, you are not in the possession of that bill anymore. You cannot double spend it. Bitcoin can also not be double spent. If you received it and if you own the key to your wallet, those Bitcoins are solely accessible and owned by you and not by anyone else. Bitcoin is private. No one knows who owns which address. This is why addresses are often called identities. If you want, you can create a new identity for every single transaction. You can, but you don't have to, reuse an address. This makes Bitcoin very private. If 10 different people want to send you Bitcoin, you can give every single person a different address. This is how you stay anonymous and private. As Bitcoin doesn't require any registration with your real name or passport, there is no connection to you in real life. This is one of the reasons why platforms like WikiLeaks accept donations in Bitcoin, or why the dark web is using it too. Bitcoin is like cash. If you give someone cash on the street, both of you don't have to know each other, and you can still make a transaction. But of course, there is much more. First of all, there are only ever 21 million Bitcoin in existence. Every Bitcoin can be divided into 100 million pieces. The smallest piece of one Bitcoin is called a Satoshi. One Satoshi, 1/100 million of a Bitcoin. To compare it with US dollar, one US dollar can be divided in 100 US cents, so 1 cent is 1/100 of a US dollar. But other than US dollar or euro, Bitcoin cannot be created out of thin air. The total amount is fixed to 21 million. So how can you get Bitcoin? Bitcoin can be earned by securing and running the Bitcoin network. As this part is quite technical and difficult, I will not explain it in this video. An easier way to own Bitcoin is to exchange Bitcoin with another currency, or buy Bitcoin from someone, or get paid in Bitcoin for work, instead of getting paid in euro, for example. You can exchange Bitcoin for euro or US dollar or any other currency the same way you can exchange US dollar for GBP, for example. But why does Bitcoin have value? To be honest, before Bitcoin, I never thought about the question why money has specific value. I had no idea where it came from, the state, the government, and I didn't really care. But with more and more people calling Bitcoin an alternative to traditional cash, I became interested to learn more about it. You could say the value of a product is defined by its importance of utility. Meaning, if a product is very useful, can be used for many things, it is worth a lot. But the argument doesn't hold. Life could not exist without water, but water seems to be less expensive than diamonds. Scarcity is important too. Scarcity, how many diamonds exist and how many people want them, is an important factor. Let it be a bottle of wine or a Picasso painting. Marx once said, the value derived from the labor used to produce it. Growing a tomato is easier than growing a cow, so cow meat is more expensive than tomatoes. But all this didn't really explain to me the value of Bitcoin, so I looked into the US dollar. The name dollar was derived from a place that produced the first silver coins, a valley that was called Joachimsthal. The coin was called Thaler. Throughout the time, Thaler became dollar. So there we go, first dollars were silver coins. With the introduction of the dollar more than 200 years ago, the dollar was basically a certificate for gold. At any time you could go to the bank or government, give them your dollar and receive your gold. Gold was scarce back then and it's scarce today. It has a high scarcity and there is nothing more scarce than Bitcoin today. Think about it, there are only ever 21 million Bitcoin. Back to the topic. Good money, how Austrian economics call it, cannot come from thin air. Why does anyone like Pablo Picasso's paintings and pays a certain amount of US dollar or Bitcoin for it? Nobody knows, and it doesn't matter. Bitcoin can easily be money. Scarcity is important, and it's very difficult to find anything scarcer than Bitcoin. Today, the dollar and the euro and basically all government-issued currencies are centrally planned and controlled. At any time, governments can create money out of thin air, and there's nothing we can do about it. We need money to pay for goods and services, and when the government needs money, for example, to fight a pandemic, they create money. This leads to problems, though. Money needs to be in balance. There can't be free money, or everyone would take as much as they want. And money would become totally worthless. Hyperinflation would start. One person that received the Nobel Prize in 1974 for economics is Hayek. He described the value of money in time. There are two types of people, he said. One type that has money, one type that needs money. Someone who has a very high time preference needs money at this very moment to buy champagne in the club or to start a business. These people usually borrow that money from someone who has a low time preference. Someone who has saved money, usually through banks. The interest they ask for is the balance between these two parties. For what percentage are you willing to lend money? This is what Hayek received the Nobel Prize for. The natural rate of interest is the balance between low and high time preference. Today, money is completely out of hand. You borrow it for free from the bank, and there is no limit. Other than in Bitcoin, there is an unlimited number of dollars or other fiat currencies, and this number grows at an incredible increasing speed. We have the problem that governments create money. Nearly 80% of all US dollar ever created have been created in less than 1.5 years. 4,000 billion, 21% in 229 years, 19,200 billion dollars, 79% in the last 16 months, in the years January 2020 to May 21. Bitcoin is really difficult to imagine, inflation too. We trust central banks, central authorities to not cause inflation. Bitcoin has no central authority and its supply is clearly limited and known in advance. No more people at any point in the history of the world have thought about what money is, or how central banks work, or how money is created. I don't see the existence of fiat money and central banks as unchangeable. Bitcoin was able to educate more people on economics than any book, and we are just getting started. Bitcoin is good money, accessible through a public and permissionless peer-to-peer network for every single person in the world. Become a Bitcoiner, continue to educate yourself, speak to others, and ask questions. I promise you that you won't regret it.